Let's go, girls.
Hello, and welcome back to Feminist Cocktail Hour. I'm JC, and today we have a huge Halloween show. We have a creepy cocktail, a boo-tiful bite, and a fabulously frightening feminist icon, who I'm excited to discuss with my guest today, none other than actress and Broadway star, Julia Murney. Hello, Julia. Thank you for joining me.
Hi, JC. I'm so happy to be here.
Oh, I'm so glad. I'm so glad you're able to make it. Now, Julia actually has some like insider knowledge, some expertise on our Lady of the Hour, the Wicked Witch of the West. Is that right, Julia?
Herself, yes. I played her, the character that she became in the novel and then subsequently the musical Wicked.
Amazing. Now, I have had the incredible honor of sharing the stage with Julia myself 100 years ago. And that, of course, comes with some amazing backstage perks because Julia is an incredible baker, and today she is going to be sharing one of her favorite recipes with us. Tell us about it.
This is a pumpkin chocolate loaf. Super, I have a cable show style. I've laid out all the ingredients right here, and this makes me so happy. And it's just, it's delicious and autumnal. We wanted to go for something that had the autumnal. So you've got flour. Here's the part that makes it autumnal. Cinnamon, nutmeg, ginger, ground cloves, baking soda, salt, brown sugar, oil, orange juice. Yes. Sugar, pumpkin puree, and chocolate chips.
Amazing. I love this. I think it's going to go great with the cocktail that I'm pulling together. Now, I struggled a little bit with the naming of this cocktail. I was going to go for an Osmopolitan, but I felt it wasn't quite right because this drink is like has a different flavor profile than a Cosmopolitan. So then I thought an Oz show fuel because it's a riff on a Moscow mule. But eventually, after talking to Julia, actually, we came up with the idea that it could be a Thropptail in honor of Elphaba's name in the book Wicked in the musical, Elphaba Thropp. So to make this Thropptail, you need some vodka. I'm using a caramel vodka, but any vodka works fine. I'm going to use some ginger beer, some lemon juice, and some green apple syrup.
Indeed. And if I may, would you like a fun fact about
yes.
Wicked? Gregory Maguire, he named her Elphaba. Do you know why?
No.
He named her in honor of the man who wrote the original books that the film is based on, L. Frank Baum, Elphaba. That's how she got named.
Oh my God, I love it.
Bam.
Amazing. Great. Well, I made this drink because it's obviously appropriate for our green girl, Elphaba. Although I will say, L. Frank Baum in the original novel did not depict her as being the green girl that we think of her as today. So the character of the Wicked Witch of the West was originally introduced in L. Frank Baum's children's novel, The Wonderful Wizard of Oz. Now, this Wicked Witch, the biggest difference between her and the Wicked Witch that we know were actually these like physical attributes. For one thing, she wasn't green. She was described as having like peach skin and blonde hair. She was short and chubby with like mangled pigtails and one eye. And never with a broom, always with an umbrella, actually.
Because she's allergic to water.
Exactly. See, it makes a lot of sense. She was, of course, in the illustrations depicted with the, you know, standard conical hat, but she was not described as wearing black. In fact, in most of the illustrations, she's seen wearing orange, which is not at all how I think of her personally, but it's very on brand for Halloween because with her round little figure and her orange dress, she looks a little bit like a pumpkin.
She looks like a little pumpkin, and you know what I'm doing right now? I'm tying my hair back, because you know what's going to happen? I'm
what?
About to start cooking.
Yes!
I'm cooking. You ready? So
I'm totally.
Shall I start with the dry ingredients?
Yes, please.
Cool. So what we're going to do is we're going to put in a medium bowl, whatever that means to you, the flour, all the dry ingredients, basically. The flour, the cinnamon that smells like love, the salt, the baking soda, Oh, all of the baking soda. Nutmeg. Oh, you guys, it smells so good. Cloves. I like holding it up, like you could, ginger.
It's very Rachel Ray.
I'm super Rachel Ray. Sugar. Oh yes, wait for it. Oh, thank you. And the brown sugar. I'm gonna whisk it all together. Bam.
So you pulling together all of those dry ingredients actually speaks to one of the things that carries over between Baum's original novel and the 1939 film that all of us are so familiar with. The fact that the Wicked Witch was, of course, water-soluble. Baum said that this was because all of the evil had dried up the Wicked Witch. That is the only explanation that he gave, and there's no explanation given in the film as to why she, you know, just melts. The film, 1939, MGM starred Judy Garland as Dorothy and Margaret Hamilton as the Wicked Witch of the West. Although Hamilton was not the original choice. The original choice was an actress named Gail Sondergaard. Gail Sondergaard was known more for being like a femme fatale. And the original concept for the Wicked Witch, as designed for Gail Sondergaard, was for the Wicked Witch to be sort of, you know, glamorous, a la the Wicked Queen in Snow White, a movie that had been very successful just a few years prior. So the producers came around to deciding that they really felt that the Wicked Witch should be, you know, a more traditional, ugly, witchy witch. As soon as they made this decision, Gail Sondergaard was out. She had no interest. Exactly. She was like,
thank you so much. I must go somewhere else.
Exactly. I mean, she's a lady in her 40s. It was not a time that she was interested in, like, leaning into that stereotype. Enter Margaret Hamilton, who was totally cool with it. Margaret Hamilton, who was now working, taking bit parts in Hollywood. She had recently divorced. She was, you know, supporting herself and her 3-year-old son. And she was only 36 years old.
I'm just going to say that 36 in 1936 was a lot different than 36 in whatever year we're in now, because time has no meaning.
Time has stopped, but it's very disturbing to me that, like, I am just a smidgen, just a couple years younger than she was when she took on that role. It blows my mind. Now, I think that it's partially a sign of the time, but I also think it's a little bit the fact that, of course, they reintroduced something new to the character of the Wicked Witch of the West, something that made her, you know, age up a little bit. There were a lot of witch stereotypes that we embraced, you know, with the Wicked Witch of the West. Obviously, the conical hat, which we talked about. This is a symbol of witches that dates way back, like before the 1700s. The black clothing of a witch, you know, that just comes from villains, right? For ages and ages, we've viewed black as the color of nefarious characters. And the brooms probably came from the fact that, like, actual Wiccans used brooms in their fertility, you know, ceremony. These things all feel like cartoon witches. And of course, the cartooniest thing of all that they bring to the MGM film is the fact that she has green skin, something that they added, just like the ruby slippers in the book. They're originally silver slippers. And her skin was green because, of course, green looks fabulous in Technicolor.
And green is definitely a very large sort of plot point in the musical Wicked, as well as the novel.
Yeah. Yes, absolutely. And the musical Wicked is also adapted from a novel, just like the film was adapted from a separate novel.
Yes, and the novel Wicked is written by Gregory Maguire, and he wrote it in 95, and I actually read it. I was working in Norfolk, Virginia, and I was working with Stephen Schwartz, who ended up writing the musical Wicked. And I just went into a bookstore, and on the new and noteworthy table was this novel called Wicked. I was like, ooh, what's that? And I pick it up and I read it and I went nuts for it. I loved it. And I told everybody. Now, Stephen swears that he was first told about it like a year or two later, that he was on a boat with some friends or something. And I'm like, I feel like it was me. The novel is sort of a prequel. It's a prequel of everything basically that happens before Dorothy arrives. And it is about these two young women, Glinda Upland, her name is Galinda, and she is a rich, popular young woman, and this girl, Elphaba Thropp. And through a various circumstances, Elphaba and Glinda are forced to be roommates at university, and they hate each other until they discover that perhaps there is something to learn from the other person, and they end up actually being very close friends. Everything gets flipped on its head, and for that you'll have to see the show. But here's the show I can give you right now. The wet ingredients. Ha 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 ha.
Yes!
Here we go. Pumpkin. That's a wet ingredient. Into a bowl. Ooh, it's so slimy and fabulous. So you do the pumpkin, you do the orange juice, you do the oil. You whisk that around a bit. I'm now obviously putting the wet ingredients into the dry, and then I'm going to put in the two eggs that are room temperature. But yeah, so you just combine all the wet ingredients just like you think you do, and it will be a little bit lumpy. Don't try and like beat the heck out of all of it.
You're getting way ahead of me. I feel like I have to catch up with you, and I have to start like working on this cocktail so I have a pairing for you.
Oh, get in there. Get in there. And so all anyone needs to do is that I'm gonna finish mixing this. I'm gonna put it in a sprayed loaf pan. But again, if you're making cupcakes or you're making it a different way, rock on with your bad self. Cocktail, go.
All right, so here's what you're gonna do. You can make this a mocktail. You can make a family-friendly version, and you can start with something like a caramel simple syrup, like you put into coffee. I instead am putting in some caramel vodka. We're gonna throw 2 ounces into our cocktail shaker. But our other ingredients are non-alcoholic ingredients appropriate for your mocktail. You're gonna do 1/2 ounce of your lemon juice right here. And then we're going to do 3/4 ounce of this Monin green apple syrup. I love the color. It couldn't be like
there's
more
green
on brand. I know, that's exactly. Right. It couldn't be more on brand for the Wicked Witch of the West. Now, when Margaret Hamilton was, you know, being turned green, she had some serious issues. On the tamer end of the spectrum, she said that by the end of filming, her skin was just like perpetually green, that she couldn't get it off. What were your experiences like, Julia, with your green makeup?
That was actually not dissimilar. When you're seeing yourself in the mirror for about 3 hours, all green, your eye kind of gets used to that. So then after the show, you wipe it off and you take the shower and you look in the mirror and you're like, yeah, I think I've got it. Cool. Then you go out. And then I started seeing pictures of myself at the stage door with people. And I looked just the slightest bit seasick because it was sort of still there. And it's always in your hairline. And I was blonde at the time. So it's always in your hairline and in your ears.
How long does it take you to get into the makeup?
It takes, at least in my day, I don't know if it's changed up, 1/2 hour. Yeah, so at 1/2 hour prior to curtain, I would have to be in the chair in half of my costume, and my greenifier would come in and he would start painting me up. It's all done with a paintbrush. It's a water-soluble MAC makeup, the green part is. And he would start painting me up, and then at a certain time, the hair guy would come in and he would start pin curling my hair. So I'm like this, getting painted, because you're painted up to here and your whole face, back of your neck, and about to there. But yeah, so you just, they do you up, and then they, as the show goes, you get touched up. If you sweat, they'll touch up the green.
Well, they have to, obviously, because it's a makeup that, as you said, is water-soluble,
right.
So you can just sweat it out.
This is
very different, of course, from Margaret Hamilton. Like in her day,
yes,
in the 1930s, her makeup was actually copper-based. And this led to some serious issues for Margaret Hamilton. There's that big scene where she's in Munchkin Land and she descends into that like pit of red smoke. And in one of the takes of that scene, the trap went too early and she ended up basically getting singed by the fire that was creating that effect. because the makeup was copper-based, because it was metallic, it started to melt onto her skin, and it actually caused second-degree burns on her face and on her hand. She wasn't the only witch on the set of The Wizard of Oz that had, like, some drama. Her stunt double, who did that scene, the Surrender Dorothy scene, she was actually, like, riding on something that was akin to a pipe, and while she was shooting the initial take for that scene, the pipe exploded underneath her, and she was hospitalized for several weeks. I mean, these are mishaps happen. We know that. We're in yeah. theater. These kinds of things. I assume that you've never ended up hospitalized for weeks, but do you have some, you know, Wicked Witch mishaps during your time in Wicked?
Sure. Well, I mean, certainly there are all kinds of Wicked Witch mishaps that occur. None of them attached to the makeup. Or as dangerous as what Margaret Hamilton went
through. Sure, of course.
One of my favorites is there is a moment towards the end of the show where I'm standing there with Glinda in this scene, and this monkey leaps onto the stage, and I get all angry because at this point she's fully embraced her wickedness. She's like, fine, I'll be bitchy, watch me. And he's supposed to hand her a note, and then he leaves, and she reads the note and has a reaction to it that makes Glinda say, what is it? And then that sort of starts the whole rest of the show rolling to its conclusion. That's the sequence that's supposed to occur. So one night, I'm on stage being all whatever. Glinda's over there. Monkey jumps on. And as soon as he jumps on the stage, he realizes he has forgotten the note.
Oh, no.
Now, what do you do? Because he realizes in his actor brain, oh, we're not supposed to be able to speak. So he couldn't come up to me and like whisper in my ear, because I have to have something to react to for her to say, what is it, for the whole show to go to its conclusion. And he realizes he can't do that. Back to the audience, he just turns around and he looks at me and he goes, figure it out. Figure it out to me and left me on stage. That's what happened there. He just left me hanging.
I cannot believe he said that to you. Figure it out. Well, you know what though? We have to figure out this cocktail. We're almost done. We're going to pop in our ice. Our last little step here. And then we're going to shake it up. Much like Elphaba shook things up in the land of Oz. I have to say that I do feel that like Wicked is right now an extremely timely story.
You think? Actually, I have to say the novel, even more so than the musical, the novel is very political. In the novel, there are animals with a small a and animals with a capital A. And the animals with a capital A can all speak, just like the humans can. They are teachers. They are, you know, like complete all members of society. And the government of Oz, including the wonderful Wizard of Oz, who we discover is not quite as lovely as we think he is. The government wants to take away the animals' rights. And there's a very big moment in Elphaba's life when her favorite teacher, her favorite professor at university, Dr. Dillamond, who is a goat, is taken away in a rather, let's say, fascist move. he is taken away. It is interesting. Interesting is the more positive word to use, and sad is the more real word to use, that the power struggle and the need for people in power to hold on to that power in any way possible and grasp it and never let it go. And I don't care who I hurt, to hold on to what I have is something that we have seen through history over and over and over again. And I feel like we are sitting in the filth of that right now. And that's the thing, honestly, that Glinda learns. Glinda starts as a character in Wicked who is very much like, me, and Elphaba has always been someone who fights for the little guy, but every time she does something to try and fight for the perceived little guy, it gets twisted, and that's when they start calling her wicked and they start calling her evil. And so finally she goes, okay, call me whatever name you want. I'm going to do what I can to save what I can. You call me what you want. And Glinda, on the other hand, actually realizes there is power in power that can, God save me, be used for good.
It's true. I mean, what I love about Elphaba, though, is that she doesn't, like, ever give up the fight. Like, she keeps fighting through until the end, which is something that, like, feels inspiring to me in this moment, but also daunting, like, as we come up to the election, which is now, like, only a few days away. But I like to think that, like, even with, you know, where we're at, like, 4 days to the election, that there are still things we can do, right? I mean, right. We can vote.
No,
we can
absolutely.
Be out, you know, voting, obviously, that's the thing that we all have to do if you haven't already, but also making calls and texting. It's not too late to still, like, keep on keeping on. And it actually makes me think of, like, how much sometimes you can achieve in a small amount of time. A fun Wizard of Oz fact to tie it back is that Margaret Hamilton was actually only in the film, The Wizard of Oz, for a total of 12 minutes. 12 minutes, and she is considered one of the greatest villains, probably the greatest female villain in all of cinema history.
Certainly the most famous one. I mean, you say, I'll get you, my pretty, and everyone knows what that means.
Exactly. We all know what that is. So I have to be an optimist, even all in black, but, like, we can always, like, you know, create an impact even with small amounts of time. I think, speaking of impact, speaking of packing a punch, I'm going to pour this punch, anyway, this Thropptail, into my glass. And you can see here, if you look closely, that my glass actually is rimmed with some pumpkin pie spice.
Look at the color.
See that there? I know, it's very green. I'm going to top it with, like, an ounce of ginger beer. This is the thing that makes it kind of a Moscow Mule riff, the citrus, the ginger, and then that vodka in there. And I actually whipped up some of your pumpkin bread earlier today. I'm gonna try this pairing. All right, I'm gonna take a little, I'm gonna take a bite first. It's very good. Very, very autumnal. You get a good amount of the pumpkin flavor, that pumpkin pie spice. And I love the little bits of chocolate. I'm a chocoholic, and these are, like, wickedly decadent.
How dare you.
Then I'm gonna try it with the cocktail. Ooh! There's a little garnish I can put in there, a little cinnamon stick, give it a little kind of, you know, witchy twist. Oh. The cocktail's good too. It's very bright. You know, it's got that it drinks sort of the way the color comes through, but at the end, you get those really nice, like, cinnamony notes from the rim and from the ginger that's in there. It's a little bit like Elphaba. It's more complex than it seems.
That's right.
On the surface, right? Bring it
That's
all
right.
home, tying it all together. Julia, thank you so much for joining me for this episode of Feminist Cocktail Hour. Everyone, make sure to follow Julia on social media. She's incredible on Twitter and on Instagram. She also has a concert series coming up, right, Julia?
I do. I do have a concert series. Not just me, a few singers. It's called Lyrics and Lyricists. It's at the 92nd Street Y. If you go to 92y.org/lyrics or something like that, 92nd Street Y, you'll find it. It's the Lyrics and Lyricists. It's a bunch of singers singing a bunch of music in a completely empty theater. And it was very strange, but hopefully it comes out nicely.
I have no doubt it will. I mean, I've heard you sing a million times. You're incredible, whether it's, you know, a full house or just you. It's always a treat to hear you and always a treat to hang out with you. Thank
it's
you
my
again.
Treat to
so,
hang you.
Oh, thank you so much. Everyone, thank you so much for tuning in. And hey, tune in next week. I'm going to have a new lady, a new libation. Until then, cheers.
Let's go, girls. Come on.